understanding for the good of our community and thy greater glory. Amen.
Amen.
Good evening, Council President. The Mayor would like to request that the Council consider postponing the vote on Ordinance 1851. We understand that members of the Council have a number of questions about salary adjustments and the impact on the budget. We want to make sure that you have as much time as you need to get those questions answered before making a decision.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're going to get a motion. I motion we table it. So move.
Is there a second?
Second.
Are you ready for the vote?
Yes, we are.
Mr. Blakely?
So ready?
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michel?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
Ordinance number 18-51 has been completed indefinitely. Members of the governing body, next on the agenda is a presentation to introduce the budget for fiscal year 2019 by Ms. Joan Garrett.
Excuse me, Mr. Harris, I apologize, but I do have, before we do the presentation,
good evening, members of council, cabinet, and city workers, and especially the city residents of Trenton. Tonight I want to inform council that I've selected Trenton Department veteran Lieutenant Christopher Doyle as the interim police director for the city of Trenton. Chris has served with distinction with the Trenton PD for the past 23 years, has served with the United States Marine Corps, and served in northern Iraq. Lieutenant Doyle is currently the commander of our internal affairs unit, and previously to that, he served in the Criminal Investigation Bureau and the Mercer County Homicide Task Force. As you know, Pedro Medina has served with distinction as our interim police director for the past 90 days and has been on loan from the Mercer County Sheriff's Department at no cost to Trenton taxpayers. I want to especially thank Pedro for his service and look forward to continued working with him in his role as under-sheriff. Under Pedro's direction, Trenton Police Department has made progress in changing the culture of the department and putting more boots on the streets. I believe Lieutenant Doyle is well-suited to continue the progress and serve our city residents with distinction. Thank you, Council.
Thank you.
I'm sorry? My understanding that it's not not on for tonight, and then we'll put it on for the next council meeting.
We can do a motion.
Sorry?
That is incorrect, actually. Before you take formal action of this nature, it needs to be reduced to writing in a form of a resolution. There's been no resolution before.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Council President.
Now, Mr. Harrison, we continue
with the presentation of the 2019 municipal budget.
Yes.
Ms. Joan Garrett, City of Trenton Budget Officer.
Mr. Miller, can you say something?
I just want to raise one point. This is the introduction of the budget. It's not a public hearing on the budget. Public hearing will be scheduled to take place at a later time. So the purpose of tonight's meeting is not for public comment.
Mr. Morelli, would you give them the date?
establish the date, I believe the clerk can determine it, of November 20th.
So we would just let the public know that on November the 20th, they can come forward and speak on this budget, but not before then, staying in, within the guidelines of the law. Thank you.
Thank you, Council President. Well, I guess I got here. I'm happy to be here.
Thank you.
So a couple things I want to say before I present the budget, the budget slides for this season. Everyone here has received a budget binder. It was a budget project that was launched in 2018. It's basically used to serve one product, to serve four customers. That is council, department heads, our finance department, as well as, you know, senior leadership, mayor, chief of staff, and business administrator. So I just wanted to make sure you knew that. There was an additional, as part of my review, when we then released the budget document, there was a $290,000 reclass. So that is why I provided to you an updated budget model, as well as the offset, which was in unallocated appropriations. And that is the present that was provided to you today. So that updated budget model and the unallocated expenses can then be put into your budget book as a replacement page for those pages. Okay. And I guess last but not least, let me just take a minute from him on a personal level to thank my husband, who's here today, for supporting me during this very difficult budget season. So thank you very much. All right, so here we go. This is this year's 2019 budget. Timeline. Again, just to repeat, I'm going to actually say this. My full name is Joe Garrett, and I'm the budget officer and have been for the last, this is my fourth introduction from the beautiful city of Trenton. So let's, this is a traditional timeline that I've presented to so we can get an idea of what's where we are now, what's in front of us. Obviously, the last meeting we did our ordinance to exceed the municipal budget. We went through the first reading of that, and that just basically gives us additional appropriations to do to make it just a little bit easier on us when we're preparing this budget from a financial standpoint. Of course, tonight we're presenting the budget to everybody, and on before October 31st, we're about to submit a transitional aid application to DCA. After this, sometime in December, January, at dates to be determined by the Council President, we will have departmental workshops. At that point, the materials that were presented by department will be, we'll have a conversation that will include the department heads. As we stated already, on the 20th, we'll have the public hearing on this introduced budget. And right after that, pretty much we begin to go through what's called a budget examination. Process. That's either updating numbers that we didn't have previously to be updated, or something that is identified through the budget examination process with DCA. That may or that may not produce budget amendments. It's really hard to know what that will produce. So once that's completed, of course, we have kind of got our bearings as to what financial impacts will be made to this introduced budget. Then the council will. We'll prepare budget amendments, but the council will introduce those budget amendments and then eventually approve those budget amendments. And I'm, you know, putting something around the middle of January as the date for that to happen. Eventually, though, we do publish those budget amendments, depending on different criteria based on the magnitude of those budget amendments, and then hopefully somewhere in that February timeline, we're adopting the budget. And most people do ask me, why are we adopting it so late? Well, it's because traditionally, at least traditionally, we have not gotten notification as to what our transition aid would be. So I'm just trying to add enough layers, if you will, into the timeline so that, you know, we have some reasonable expectations as to when things will happen. And this is just, again, a very brief financial overview on the 2019 budget versus the 2018 adopted budget. And I apologize, it says introduced, it should say 2019 introduced. And so, as you can see, I will be talking to those variations in some of the other slides, but the overall change has been about $3.6 million increase in revenue, not really increase, we'll talk about that shortly, and then another 3.6 increase on the appropriations. Okay, so this year's budget, the proposed 2019 budget totals $208.5 million. This includes grants that would be from $7 million. This is an increase of $3.6 million as compared to fiscal year 2018 adopted. It's primarily due to, I took about an additional $4.4 from the city surplus as compared to last year. And so that's what's driving most of that revenue increase. And that was offset by about 0.9 reduction, just a little under a million reduction in grants. So most of it is, you know, against surplus related. This year, our appropriations, again, as they were last year, are driven by increases in the police and fire retirement systems amounts for both 1.2 on the PFRS side and another 0.4 million on the PERS side. And this was primarily related to, and so in addition to that, it's primarily other changes, our salary range for fire of 1.1 and police of 2.6. On the fire and police side, it's primarily related to the fact that some of it, at least, is the loss of the safer grant of fire and for the props grant. I guess one of the things I want to mention on the PERS comment there is that we showed, you know, this year it's about 1.6 million. Last year I think it was somewhere around 1.9 million. These are amounts that we really have no control over. They're based on state mandated increases. And right now, the municipalities in generally across the board are paying more for those amounts due to the projected investment rate of return assumptions that are not favorable to us. So it's a little bit, obviously costing us more money, or continues to cost us, more money that way. So those are dollars that, again, we don't have too much control over. They're state mandated. Again, our tax levy itself increased by $1.6 million. It was $80.9 million in fiscal 18, and it went to $82.5 million this year. It really just represents, we're right on the cusp of things, a 2.02% increase. So just going over the revenues again, dropping down the revenue by the portion related to grants, we're at $206.8 million. Right now, the city is requesting $25 million in transition aid. Right now, as far as the budget goes, we've only included $9 million because we're required just by budget law to only anticipate what was anticipated last year, received last year. Other pieces of that revenue summary are our consolidated municipal aid and also the energy receipts tax. And again, that's about $30.0 million and $28.9 million respectively. I'll have a pie chart on that so you see kind of what that looks from a visual standpoint. But at least in words, that's what it looks like. Again, the overall general, I just tell everyone mostly for state aid. It's primarily taxes, followed by state aid, a little bit of grants, some revenue coming in lieu of taxes, and then, of course, other revenue, which can be, miscellaneous things that we just that change varying from year to year. Again, the consolidated property tax relief, I think we're at 60 from the first chart we were at, about 67.9 million, and that's the breakdown of that revenue in terms of how it came in, what proportion of that total, mostly consolidated property tax, followed by energy receipts, followed by the transition. So I guess regarding just right now, that's just what the position that the city is in from a financial standpoint. And right now, the mayor is working with the state legislators and governors and the governor to seek additional state aid. The other thing I wanted to mention in terms of the revenue before we talk about the budget is this chart on loss of state aid. On the revenue outlook, we have pushed all the numbers that we can to the extent that we can on the budget side of it. That requirements allows us to do that by budget law. So when we go through that budget process or the budget amendment process, there could be items that could change. And so therefore, if they do change, they could either have a favorable, they would possibly have an unfavorable impact. So the key thing I'm just trying to say on this revenue piece, we pushed revenues as far as we could in terms of actually the introduction and how much we could take from a budget loss standpoint. So hopefully, we'll see how that goes, and hopefully that will remain pretty much intact. This is a chart that was put together by a financial consultant. It's a loss of state aid, and you can see over the course of since 2009, that has been reduced to about $15.6 million. Obviously, that didn't help us, and I'm just going back to those periods. Just again, this 2019 appropriation summary, it's basically a summary of the budget model that breaks down each little piece of it. So generally, as we've been talking about our department costs, around about 50% of the total. A lot of it is related to progression promotions, and also, as I mentioned before, the loss of the state grant for both fire and police are clearly our biggest appropriation due to the size of that group and the services that we're providing. Fringe benefits also are about 15% this year's appropriations. Right now we are anticipating, which will only be for a portion of the year, what the state health, we will move the state health benefit plan. And right now, based on what information I was given to date, I think it will change a little bit, but it's projected to have an overall favorable impact of a little under $1 million. Statutory and pension, again, it's about 11% of our total appropriations. Again, this is mostly again driven by the police and fire retirement system and public employees retirement system. And our debt service is about 12% of the total 2019 appropriations. And the rest of it is whole. These are reserve for uncollected taxes. What portion the city matches for grants. So we have 1.7, I think this year we're matching about a little over 200,000 for grants. It includes our library budget, some small capital items that are placed in OE, and other expenses, sorry. And then of course, some public judgments here and there. So again, generally I tell people our overall appropriations, 40% of it is salary and wage, about 10% of it is departmental expenses. And then there's a whole other piece of it, which is unallocated expenses. That's in your other, in your book. And those are the components of what makes that up. So talking about the tax impact of the budget, again, repeating but this time including the total municipal tax levy, this time including type 2 school and minimum library tax. That total, which is on page 3 of your budget model sheet, is $82.5 million versus $80.9 million in fiscal 18. Right now, the municipal tax rate is from 3.45 cents in fiscal year 18 to 3.56 cents in fiscal 19. That is currently representing a 3% increase or 11 cents. And that tax rate right now is basically due to the decrease of the values of our real estate base, where it went down by $80 million. And even if we made no changes, if we just kept all the numbers the same and made no changes to the 2018 to the 2019 just kept the numbers, that would have represented a 4 cent tax increase on its own, from 3.45 cents to 3.49 cents. So 4 cents of that 11 cents relates to the impact of the revaluation. Okay, so now some questions.
I just want to ask about this 4 cent. So now we're looking at 11 cents, and if we are able to scale back, we will only be able to scale back to the 4% because we need that 4% no matter what.
Yeah, one could say that, yes, but yeah, I mean, yes, I would say that that would be the lowest we could possibly go, because obviously the original basis is last year would be 4 cents higher, so yeah.
No, I
did. Okay. But I don't know if I would hope that we could get the current amount since right now is when I chose to look at it.
So I also want to thank you, Ms. Garrett. I know that you have been doing the yeoman's job, the woman's job of putting this budget together. What assistance do you need to actually not work so hard? I mean, is this normal for you to have this type of pressure on you?
Yeah, I think what has happened is, as I said, we've had a budget examiner in the budget since the 2017 budget. There have obviously were other competing interests in terms of hiring. But I have a signed waiver from our current mayor looking to see that the person that I selected for that position would be hired. And then, of course, unfortunately, would be added to a very difficult situation once the current budget examiner is out on leave. And unfortunately, the timing of that could have come at the worst time. But, you know, obviously, we care about his health and well-being, so he has to take care of himself. So. But this tremendous stress that it was primarily related to the loss of the current budget examiner for this season, and then also the fact that an anticipated hire has just not taken place yet.
So you don't anticipate that this is going to cause a strain in the future?
No, as long as realistically, as one person, it's almost backbreaking, but we do need to get two people working with me on budgets as we move forward now. Okay, especially in light of the individual who is not here right now. So at least if our current hire, that is where the sign by the waiver takes place, or the mayor takes place, that would be very beneficial.
Okay, thank you.
Councilman
Bryan.
So have we gotten to the point about the surplus?
Yeah, we did mention about the surplus, but we did, that I can talk to that issue.
Yeah, can you talk a little bit about our existing surplus and the role that plays, and then I'll ask a follow-up question.
Okay, I mean, what I can tell you is right here, this year, we took 100% of the post surplus. That was $16,394,000. What I can say is it's too early in this fiscal year cycle to project that the surplus would be going into the next budget season, just too soon. But because we took 100% of it this year, it certainly is anticipated that it will be less than that. But I don't want to commit to what that number could be, because it's way too early in the accounting cycle to make that projection. It's, you know, impacted by when we do better than we anticipated revenues, and then we spend less than we anticipated on the appropriation side. That's a simple, very simple version of what, you know, helps to create that surplus.
Okay. Is that normal to spend all of your surplus?
It's not ideal, no.
What are some options? What do we normally use the surplus for? Will we put it in reserves for a rainy day? Do we,
No, we historically, and I don't know how long you've reached me about 60% of our surplus, at least in the 3 years that I've been here. This is my fourth budget introduction. So generally, we do need as much of that surplus that we've generated to help us, you know, keep that municipal breakdown and have it be attractive to our taxpayers.
So another question I have is, what's changed from the last few years and the current and the future? Will that serve, like next year's budget, will that serve as a problem in terms of us? Are we keeping the can down the road?
Yeah, I think obviously one of the primary issues is the fact that we, both the SAFER grant, with about 64 firefighters and 12 police officers, those individuals who are providing, you know, beautiful service to our city, we are paying for that as opposed to having a grant cover that expense. So that's some of the challenge, you know, that senior leadership as well as, you know, budgets and, you know, we're going to have to, you know, potentially look at.
So just to draw it down, the submitted budget basically draws down our savings account to pay existing expenses. And say if there is an economic downturn in the next few years, we would be in a position where things would be much more difficult to address in terms of our existing priorities.
Yeah, let's put this, we have spent, as Colin is mentioning to me, and we put a great deal of effort in, into looking at what our future revenue goals and cycle are. So, you know, we're going to be talking about that very shortly, because obviously, you know, we can't, like you say, keep hitting the savings account and then not having a way to offset that. So there's a very strong effort on the part of this administration to remedy that open issue. And, you know, we're going to, we will talk to that now. I'm going to I'll move the slides along as Colin takes the leadership role here and the answer and goes through the slides. But once we go through those slides, then I would say, you know, we can have another conversation once we present that to you. Would that be okay?
That would be fine.
Okay.
An ordinance enabling the city to
We simply have not implemented a collections process for that ordinance. We are working and intend to work with the Department of Inspections to begin collection and enforcement of that surcharge. That is all paid parking, so that includes places like Waterfront Park, like the Cure Insurance Arena, anyone who charges for parking, our special events, anything like that, we are entitled to a 7% surcharge. So we will be working on implementing that and collecting that surcharge. We also, as I'm sure council members are aware, we have a vacant property fee ordinance that calls for a scaling cost for those individuals who own property that remains vacant and unmarketed. Again, this does not apply to those properties that are simply in process of finding tenants, but for those properties that are truly vacant and are not being marketed, we charge a fee. But our Department of Inspections and the Department of Housing and Economic Development will be adding additional staff paid for by the trust account that takes in this these fees to beef up enforcement, summonses, and really make sure that we are receiving the money we are owed from these vacant properties. We are also moving forward with a blight reduction strategy. The mayor's 1,000 homes in 1,000 days initiative is a key portion of this, and our hope is by improving the situation and assisting with both demo and other infrastructure support for our vacant properties, we can make sure that those properties transition to home ownership and rental that allows for them to be returned to the tax rolls. And that, of course, both helps our residents receive reasonable and quality housing at reasonable prices, but also allows us to raise our tax revenue and our tax rentals and hope to chip at that $80 million that we lost between fiscal year 18 and this year. And finally, the mayor's office is undergoing a contract review process. We will be looking at all of our contracts, reviewing each of them, but also reviewing the process by which we engage in these contracts. And we're hopeful that that will allow for increased accountability, increased transparency, and helps us track those contracts and the expenditures of the appropriations so that we can have a better handle on that. And we hope that by doing that, we will see up to 2-4% in reductions from our contract spending as we move forward. Now I finished with the presentation, so if you guys have any questions.
Thank you, President Brown. So regarding the parking meters, can we discuss the anticipated revenue goals for the parking meter policy? How much money net, excluding the money that we'd be spending to bolster parking enforcement officers?
So currently, it is difficult for us to project because our current situation of enforcement is so limited. But I can say that currently we take in about $180,000 per year for meters alone. We expect to see that increase by at least 300%. When we move forward with this new rollout.
Is that $180,000 net after our expenses?
Yes.
Okay.
And this, as an aside, this is a utility, parking utility is its own utility. So of course, as council is aware, that budget process is slightly different, but we do expect that we will see, we're hoping to reach $1 million in revenue, but I think a conservative estimate is a 300%.
Another point I wanted to make, I've done some research on this around the regressive nature So what happens is someone gets a parking ticket, they can't afford to pay it, they lose their license, and then there's this vicious cycle to feed our budget deficit on the backs of people who can afford to pay less. So I would definitely encourage the mayor to be cognizant of that. There's a lot of research out there. LA is kind of infamous for using parking tickets as a way to gouge the poor and those who can't afford it the most. And so I would definitely hope that we are using best practices around the country to ensure that we are not taking advantage of poor people. And so, like I said, this is among the most progressive forms of taxation to impact poor minorities and folks. And I can see some research on that. I just want to make sure that we're being as responsible as we can with the population that we see.
Of course, and Councilman, we welcome that information. We have certainly taken these things into account, and I want to stress to Council, and you, of course, Councilman Blakely, that the rollout here is for our downtown area, not our residential districts. So the individuals who are most affected by this are our businesses and visitors. And in fact, the business community has been clamoring for this. We have a serious issue with state workers occupying our downtown street parking, which prevents those patrons who wish to attend to our downtown businesses from going. And this, as well as some increased parking strategies, for example, adding off-peak street parking to places like West Front Street, rather, are hopefully going to enable us to better serve our business constituents without putting that burden on our residents.
That's fantastic. Another question I have is the parking surcharge. Can you tell me how much money we are anticipating when that gets done?
We can get those numbers for you. Unfortunately, we've just begun our process for identifying what those revenues would be. So we'll keep you in the loop, but we do not yet know exactly how much money that surcharge is likely.
Well, in the future, when you introduce possible or future revenue goals, it would be helpful to actually have and know what those goals are before introducing them. I think what happens is, you know, we want to make sure that we're using our time wisely. And, not having that number is something that I think is just unacceptable. Like, in terms of saying that this is a possible goal, and you don't have an idea or a number in terms of what this can actually generate. So, just in the future, I would like to know that parking surcharge goal so that we can have all the information. So that's one thing. Another question I have is, do you have a goal in mind for the vacant property citation policy that you have talked about?
Well, Councilman, I preface it by saying we don't want to overpromise and underdeliver.
I'm asking you can overpromise. I just need a number.
Our original target was approximately $500,000, and we're working toward that number. Our hope is that this increased enforcement will allow us to get closer to that.
And that's $500,000 net after the expenditure on increased staff?
It is gross.
It's gross, so it's not net. Okay. And another question I have is around the light reduction. The 1,000 homes in 1,000 days, has there been, what's the number so far? We're about 100 days within the mayor's administration. Can you tell me how many homes have actually been eliminated?
We have not brought the homes for that project online yet, but it is a process.
Do you think we're going to be able to get to that 1,000 homes in 1,000 days?
The mayor is committed to that program, and we, the administration, are committed to helping make sure that's going to happen.
And my final question about this portion of the meeting is the contract review. Can you give me an example of a contract review that would have 2 to 4% hand out in terms of reductions in cost?
So one of the things we talk about, and I know we talk about this a lot with the city attorney, is ensuring that we're paying those bills the way they should be paid and that we're receiving the services that we need, and making sure that there's no waste and no issuance of contracts that may have been better served either rolling them together or procuring through a different mechanism.
Has that started so far?
We have begun the process, and I'm sure we will see fruits of that very soon.
Councilwoman Paul?
Yes. Mr. Blakely really covered my question regarding your anticipated revenue around these revenue strategies. But I would just add an additional question. I just wanted to see if I get the status from the business administrator and Warren Jones, well, and you, Mr. Cherry, on the MOU and the transitional aid. And what the status is, and what conversations you've had with ETCA as to what their, are there any indicators that they have given out or around the amount of money that we can expect to see?
So,
and frankly, the timeline of the termination of that, of the agreement.
We have not had conversations about a timeline for termination, but we have started conversations within the last month about asking for this increased aid. As Jalen said, we are working with our state legislators and the governor's office, as evidenced by the governor's executive order, in trying to generate that additional revenue and what mechanism that revenue might take. Councilwoman, I can assure you that moving out of the transition program is a goal of the administration as well.
So, just so I'm clear, so the 8.9 million, is that committed? Is that
We have no specific commitment yet, but the way the budget regulations permit is for us to anticipate the same amount of transition aid that we received last year. So that does not reflect what we are requesting, but it reflects what the budget regulations permit us to anticipate in our budget.
Have the state committed to a date of given us the number?
They have not.
Thank you.
That is certainly something that we are considering, local hiring, minority
city's collective year?
I can get that number for you. It is in our budget, but I'll get that number for you for what we collected in fiscal year 18.
Sort of like cut out, and the city could get that revenue for
Not a problem, yes.
Mr. Harris, what did we have on the agenda as far as the advice and consent for Mr.
There's a point of position on the floor. It's come to my attention that President McBride asked a private citizen to stop live streaming a police proceeding. I am vexed. Mr. Harris, does the council president have the power to stop a private citizen from live streaming these proceedings? And the legal department can ask that as well. I will have that question for the legal department as well.
Mr. Harris, before you answer that,
I ask Mr. Harris.
Before you answer that question, I would like to intercede.
I have a question. I don't need you to intercede. I ask a question.
Mr. Lately definitely does not have all the information. He wants to grant.
Let's not about grandstanding. I'm asking a question. Does the council president have the right, the prerogative, the scope of power to tell a private citizen that they cannot live stream these proceedings? Does she have that right? That's a question of the clerk, as well as the law director, not President McBride.
So my answer to that question, is that a member of the public does have the legal authority to record any public meeting as long as their actions are not being disruptive. So that is the answer to my question. Take it as you will.
Thank you, Mr. Harris. What about your insight, Mr. Law Director?
Mr. Harris correctly stated the law, as I understand it, that a private individual has the right to videotape a meeting as long as they do not disrupt the meeting. There is no case talking about live streaming.
Now, for the record, for everybody's information, I have been working with this gentleman for the last 4 weeks, getting them to come in this council meeting and test out the live streaming, the audio, and everything that goes with it, because my colleagues put up a resolution and we did not have the information that we needed in order to move forward with the live streaming. So I reached out to a couple of my friends, ask them if they could get someone in to begin a process to tell us what we needed to move forward to get the live stream in this chamber. The gentleman is here on my request
Every week that he's been here, it's been because I requested them here. Mr. Blakely did not notice the gentleman has been here for the last 4 weeks.
That's not true. Don't tell me what I know. That's not true.
Now
that's
he
not
wants
true.
To interject. I'm speaking.
I know you are.
And so you need to hold your tongue.
Councilman, that's unacceptable.
You need to hold your tongue.
You're being unacceptable.
And so now he wants to make a stink out of it, but I asked the gentleman here. I asked him here so we could find out what we need to move forward to have live streaming here in this chamber.
Nobody is disputing that.
So
I am disputing.
You don't have the right to dispute anything.
No, I do. That's the only person I do.
You don't.
I do.
When you're not a part of the agreement that I have made with this company to get us all of the information that we need as far as the sound system, as far as the filming, as far as the location of the filming, how it's going to take place. So you weren't a part of that original agreement, and you cannot interject your 2 cents in now that things aren't going the way that you want them to go, but you don't even know how they were going. And so I'm not going to have this conversation.
And I would like to just say this on the record. The fact of the matter is this. You told the gentleman to stop live streaming. All I'm asking for is why did you do that?
Because we were doing runs. The gentleman and I had already discussed what were going to take place this evening. And so you had nothing to do with the agreement. And so
the mayor's office publicly announced through the transition. Well, sir, you're going to have to hear it. The fact of the matter is,
that's why we're in
the fact of the matter is, the public who's at the outside should have the ability to see what's going on here. I'm just adding it to the record. And the fact of the matter is, I'm just adding it to the record. So that's what I'm doing. It's already happening. Thank you.
That's why I'm coming.
Could you please come?
The council can't get along.
Thank you. I'm just adding that to the record so that everybody's informed that the council president has asked a private citizen to stop live streaming. We just need to stop this dictatorship.
And Mr. Blakely, you're totally out of line because there was agreement with me and this gentleman and his company and my friends.
You told
me to
stop.
And so we want to
move on.
Yes.
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes. Thank you, President, for the trust you have in me. I have been working with the city of Trenton for 27 years, and I've always been in public works. I was also, the last time I said, I was in welfare, and I have social welfare now. And from there, I moved into public works. I've been working for the public works for a long time. And I really want to work with the mayor, because of his dream is to keep the city clean. And because mayor, I know a lot of you guys are really concerned about getting the city clean and together. I believe we can do it. And we have a lot of good people in public property, public works, and based on them, I can do our good job for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda will be the acceptance of communication, petitions and reports. There are 35 items of communications, 0 petitions, and 1 report from the city clerk's office, and then the approval of revenue for the month of September 2018 and the funds collected totaling $14,537.15. Is there a motion?
So moved.
I've been living there for about 7 years. And most people in this city of Trenton know me for my business. Those that don't know me, I want to let them know I have ample experience. I was downtown Trenton for 18 years. I brought the culture to the city of Trenton. And I'm not afraid to admit it. So I left. I was in Washington, D.C. for 22 years. I worked with the district. I worked in Georgetown. I worked all over D.C. I was the point man for the district. I'm in Trenton. And every day, I ride the neighborhood. I ride the streets. That's my MO now, to see what's going down. City is every day, the buildings is falling down. They are rotting. Okay. They don't have a program. I won't say the homeless, but the have-nots. Now, there's a way of dealing with this. I'm familiar with the job situation, how the job go, and I told the city council quite some time ago, if it didn't set up some kind of mechanism to keep the big boys from buying off the property and subleasing it out to the other boys, and they click like, you know, I'm familiar with from Wall Street Bank, how the money flow. So I know what's happening in the city of Trenton. Right now, they're phasing the blacks out of everything in the city of Trenton. Someone that sees this had to step to the communications plan and let the city council know. You know, wake up the morning one side of the corner. Now, one of the main things that I want to point out to city council at this particular time is that things that are missing the black community need. That's a review board. Now, review board can save the city and the community a lot of money because a lot of things are happening in the city of Trenton. Not only happened to the people in the city, it happened to me too. Okay? First, insurance farm, land farm. There's a lot of things that accessible to other people not accepted at home. One of the things the city council has to concentrate on, now, whether you like it or not, it's not a racist situation statement on my way. See, I speak the truth. I was in business. And I know how to carve around and beat the system. You feel me? Yes. I was experiencing that. Incidentally, I was in the army too. I was in Germany in the Korean conflict. And I came here in 1956. So I know what Trenton looked like. So you got people that is taking advantage of this huge entrant on taxes. Now I hear Jamaica saying these taxes out, please, and you get a feedback and certain percentage of meters. Before I change the subject, I want to forget about the media. What they should do to start, make sure they start some senior citizen media somewhere in the downtown area without the people that are working in the state be able to galvanize and take advantage of the proper media. But somewhere in the city, because I anticipate that the rest of people, they're going to be an enterprise of people coming here from all nations. See, Trenton is the capital. One world capital. So back to what I was saying about the situation in the business part. Every community, they have their stores. The stores that sit up working against the cash registers. They got, some of them got two cash registers. Why they got two cash registers? One for the tax and one for the non-tax, not to be seen. That is like an ad machine. City got behind, and excuse me now, let me get for real. They have behind where you can't see what the price tags are. See, this is happening all over City Trenton, and it's a bona fide effort. Who is being suffered when you all trying to bring the city back and you say that you got people on this end and taking advantage of the blacks in the community? So who gonna raise that issue? Somebody that has experience and know. Don't lie, tell the truth. That's all I got to say. I'm not going to say more, but I'm not going to overdo it. I'll save some for the next time.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, and at this time, public comments are for items on the docket, resolutions, and ordinances only. So please leave your comment to docket items. Thank you. That is correct. Any resolution or ordinance that is going to be considered for action this evening. Seeing none, we will continue with the rest of the agenda. Next for consideration is new business consent agenda, which would include resolutions number 18-670, resolution 18-694, resolution 18-700, 18-702, resolution 18-705, and resolutions 18-708 to 18-710. Is there a motion to accept the consent agenda? Are you ready for the vote?
Yes.
Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
This consent agenda has been adopted. Next for your consideration is resolution 18-695, which is,
yes, Mr. Rodriguez.
I ask for this resolution to be voted separately for the others. Increase or whatever.
thing that I would like to just say about Councilman Rodriguez's position is that he had asked the administration to get back with him on that, and no one did. And so when you don't address the councilman's issues, this is the problem that you have. But someone should have gotten back with him. You can come up, Mr. Cherry, if you like. Someone should have gotten back with the councilman.
Colin Cherry, Department of Administration. We did provide the clerk with the total card numbers as Councilman Rodriguez asked for distribution to city council members. So we did provide yesterday, I believe, Mr. Clerk?
This morning, and that information was distributed to every member of the governing body.
Okay, so we can continue.
So for your consideration of resolution number 18-695, this is a resolution of the City of Trenton, County of Mercer, State of New Jersey, authorizing the submission of an application to the local finance board pursuant to NJSA 48-3-1 et sec in connection with the proposed issuance of $32,489,000 general obligation bonds, series 2019. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Are you ready for the vote?
Yes.
Mr. Blakely?
Come back to me, please.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
No.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
Resolution 18-695 has been. Next, for your consideration, is resolution 18-696. Which is a resolution exercising the option to extend a contract for 1 year awarded to SourceLink for printing and mailing services for regular, final, and corrected billing at Trenton Waterworks Utility in an amount not to exceed $157,276.47. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Are you ready for the vote?
Yes, we are.
Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
No.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
Resolution 18-696 has been properly adopted. Next, for your consideration, is resolution 18-706, which is a resolution authorizing an emergency appropriation to the state fiscal year 2019 temporary budgets of the City of Trenton's current fund. Is there a motion?
Second.
Are you ready for the vote?
Yes,
you are. Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
No.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
Resolution 18-706 has been properly adopted. Next, for your consideration, is resolution 18-707. This is a resolution consenting to the continuation of Acting Police Director Pedro Medina as Acting Director of the Police Department for a period of 90 days. Is there a
so moved.
No.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
Resolution 18-707 has been tabled. Next, for your consideration, is ordinances for first reading and introduction. Ordinance number 18-53, which is an ordinance authorizing the sale of city-owned property
identified on the city tax map as 304 East State Street, Block 608, Lot 13, to AHG Realty 2, for the sum of $30,000. Is there a motion to introduce this ordinance?
Second.
You ready for the vote?
Yes, we are.
Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
This ordinance has been properly approved on its first reading and will require a public hearing and possible adoption to be held on November 1st, 2018. Next for your consideration is ordinance number 18-54, which is an ordinance authorizing the sale of city-owned property identified on the city tax map as 326 Rutherford Avenue, Block 4403, Lot 207, to Micah Freeman for the sum of $1,000. Is there a motion to introduce this ordinance?
Second.
Are you ready for the vote?
Yes.
Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
This ordinance has been properly introduced. There will be a public hearing and possible adoption to be held on November 1st, 2018. Next for your consideration is ordinance number 18-55, which is authorizing the sale of city-owned property identified on the city tax map as 30-36 Ogden Street, Blocks 1002, Lots 2, 2.01, 2.02, 2.05, and 79-81 Southern Street, Block 1002, Lots 2003, 2004, to Says Enterprises Limited for the sum of $15,000. Is there a motion to introduce this ordinance? Seeing none, we will move on to the next item. Ordinance number 18-56, which is an ordinance authorizing the sale of city-owned property identified on the city tax map as 37 Montgomery Place, Block 2205, Lot 16, to Patrick Branch for the sum of $5,000. Is there a motion to introduce this ordinance?
So moved. Second.
Are you ready for the votes?
Yes.
Mr. Blakely?
Not here.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
This ordinance has been properly introduced on its first reading and will require a public hearing and possible adoption on November 1st, 2018. Next for your consideration is ordinance number 18-57, which is an ordinance authorizing the sale of city-owned property identified on the city tax map as 142, 150, and 178 West Hanover Street, Block 3502, Lots 45, 41, and 31, respectively, to Mass Properties Group, LLC, for the sum of $26,000. Is there a motion to introduce this ordinance? Is there a second? Failing a second, this ordinance will not be acted on. We will move on to the next item. For your consideration, ordinance number 18-58, which is an ordinance authorizing the sale of city-owned property identified on the city tax map as 117 Sherman Avenue, Block 21602, Lot 30, to Pedro Perez for the sum of $750. Is there a motion to introduce this ordinance?
So moved.
Second.
Are you ready for the vote?
Yes,
we are. Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
Yes.
This ordinance has been properly introduced on first reading and will have a public hearing and possible adoption on November 1st, 2018. Next for your consideration is ordinance number 18-59. the sale of imitation and toy firearms that can reasonably be perceived to be an actual firearm in the city of Trenton. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second. Are you ready for the vote? Mr. Blakely?
You come back to me, please.
Ms. Caldwell Wilson?
Yes.
Mr. Harrison?
Yes.
Mr. Michelle?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Ms. Vaughn?
No.
Mr. Blakely?
Yes.
Ms. McBride?
No.
Ordinance 18-59 has been properly introduced. This ordinance will require a public hearing and possible adoption to be held on November 1st, 2018. That concludes all of the new business. Next on the agenda is public comment. Susan Partell Perez. Park Perez, please come to the podium, state your name and address for the record, and please keep your comments to 10 minutes or less.
My name is Susan L. Park Perez. I live at 41 Montgomery Place. I'm a 30-plus year resident of the city of Trenton. I am concerned about two things that I think are quality of life issues. Number one is the corner of West State Street and Calhoun Street at night. The lights are out. I do have to say a thank you to Mr. Michelle for having the lights behind the State Museum up and running. They were dark. This does not present a good picture to someone who has to drive through the city of Trenton at night. Also at this corner are two bus stops where people have to wait for the bus. That is a safety issue for me because I take public transportation. For anybody who has to work a back shift and stand there and wait for the bus with poor lighting, it's an invitation to be mugged or worse. Number two, another public safety issue for me is the Foundation Academy. When they let the kids out, the parents park anywhere they want to. You cannot get a fire truck, a police car, or an ambulance up and down West State Street at those times. I've watched this happen for years. I've complained for years. I don't want to see somebody die because public safety was ignored. I do not know how the police department and the city of Trenton will handle these issues, but they are a concern for me. Thank you.
Thank you. Myla Moran.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I'm here to present a concern to the West Board.
Ma'am, excuse me, please state your name and address for the record.
Mila Moran. And I'm here to present a concern in regard to a tree.
Address.
1810 1812 Riverside Drive, Trenton, New Jersey, 08618. And Mr. Allen, I already gave you my paperwork. We have a huge tree, quite large, and half of the tree fall in the riverbank, and another half is hanging over the houses where we live. It's a serious danger, and I'm honestly afraid even to leave my house. And I addressed this issue with your newly appointed Public Works President, Director, and I handle the paperwork throughout. Nice lady representing my ward and my area, so will you please take care of this issue? I took my time to come here today to see you all, and I thank you for listening, all of us, and I'm hoping that all the tax we pay, which according to what I heard today is over 40%, we should take care of that issue. Okay, and I guess I will make it very short. I will be hearing back from you and following up. And again, I thank you for listening to me. And it's just, it's a huge tree that we're very concerned because when one part of the tree fell, the weather was quite storm, I have no home. Hopefully, I won't be there when it's dead and follow me. Okay? Thank you very much, Mia. You have a good evening. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mary Ann Horn.
I yield to the next meeting.
John Constantine. Constantine.
Constantine.
Constantine.
Good evening. I've got several concerns. One very important.
Excuse me, just for the record, please state your name and address.
115 Wolf.
Should be said. Your name?
John Constantini. Also, I see a group on a street 453 Henry. I own both of the properties. 115 Wolf Street, especially the alleyway between the 100 block of Wolf Street and the in South Clinton. Looks more like a junkyard. There are, junk loaded all over the place, plus there are vehicles out there, unlicensed, parked there. It needs to be cleaned up. Somebody's going to get hurt there. Also, 117 Point Street. It's a single family residence, and I believe it's now a turned into a house where there are four different families in there, four different people. So I was in there at one time, and each room had a separate lot on it. So that is, I think, should be looked at by the city inspection department. The other problem I had, it's all over the city, and there are other places the same way. Boarding houses, single family homes turned into boarding houses. And the people that own them are doing absolutely nothing to repair them. Big problem. Also, the vehicles in the city of Trenton. Years ago, you park a vehicle within 10, maybe 15 feet from the curb, you might have a ticket. Today you got these, they were just regular vehicles. Today you got the SUVs, you got trucks with ladders on them, parked right on the corners. And you have to go through the intersection to make a right-hand turn to see if it gets coming. Not very safe. Somebody's going to get hurt or get killed. So, if there's something you can do, sign would be appreciated.
Thank you, sir.
And so, some feedback on that, I would appreciate that.
Jonathan Biggs. Willington David. Alicia LeBron. Claudia Torres. Brandon Washington. Kenneth Owens. Tony Little.
Well, good evening. our frontline employees. We might not be fire, we might not be police, but we do a lot of the hard work. Second, I want to say that the bill that you guys voted down to oppose the oversight committee of the board of utilities. I would like to see that you guys put it back on the docket, and that there was some amendments to it. I would like to see that happen. And I also want to say that, you guys, you know, we all should be able to get along. I don't know why we're putting our foots on each other's necks here, when we should be putting our foots on the necks of DCA and the Senate, who's important, who's representing this bill. And that's all I want to say. Thank you for the meeting.
All in favor? All in favor, 62 all in favor. 55 all in favor. Once again, I'd like to say how y'all are doing this evening. I know Robin, I sent you a text trying to reach out to you, but that's okay, I'll catch you. Once again, I just learned that y'all separated the water department. I don't know where I was at, probably asleep somewhere. But like I say, I think that's a bad thing for the workers of the city of Trenton. Because to me, it just opened up the door for private companies to walk right in and take what was so long of eyes on public property. Because the last time I know that when we had a layoff, they the one that saved us. I really don't know which way that the city is headed, but I do know that the State Department is pushing for a bill. I don't like the bill. I'm against the bill because I know the only thing that's going to happen out of that American water is in there, and I know eventually they're going to take us. And I see it coming. Maybe y'all can't see it coming, I don't know. Maybe y'all can see something that I can't see, I don't know. But I know for a fact it's all political and it's all politics. And for y'all to separate that water department from public property, I think that was a bad call. And the public should really know where we had it, you know, because at the end of the election, when it's time for election time, we should be able to know who voted for it and who voted against it. I think that would be our right. So we'll know who should we vote for and who we shouldn't vote for. Because if y'all raises go through, it's definitely going to be available. Because I can see now y'all claim that maybe there's no money in the city. Y'all are heading this city, you know? And that's the bad thing about it, you know? Because when I go up there to the State House and I listen to them trying to stop the sale of the water, and that's all I hear about, American water. And D'Angelo, how he want to push it through, you know what I'm saying? And it's really sad that how money plays a big part of everything. And the only one going to suffer out of that if they sell that water will be our elderly people. Because in the water department, our water bill is going to shoot sky high for the people that can't even afford it. And y'all should have really, really not even approved that bill. Y'all should have thought a little bit harder on some of the taxpayers that they'll retire from the city of Trenton, that worked so hard for the city of Trenton, and did so much for the city of Trenton. Now I'm going back to when it was a layoff. A lot of people that work for the city of Trenton right now was working supervisor jobs. excuse me, doing a lot of jobs that they weren't even getting paid for. But yet, on negotiation time, we still finished last. How long is we gonna finish last? When is y'all gonna allow us to finish first sometime? I'm tired of being last. I'm tired of working myself to the bone and just barely ends meet. And I'm pretty sure a lot of women out here, a lot of men out here, working from paycheck to paycheck. But once again, y'all the head of the house, and y'all make these decisions. And when y'all make these decisions, y'all got to think about the public. And if you don't think about the public need to remember y'all on voting time. Because that's the only time y'all listen. Because y'all don't listen any other time. We can come to this podium, we can scream, we can holler, you can throw Paul out. You can say Paul a hardhead, or Paul ain't no good. But yes, once again, I'm speaking the truth. Because Paul saved for these rainy days. But everybody ain't like Paul, and I realize that. Because God blessed me a way to see things before it happened. So I saved for that rainy day. But a lot of people can't save like Paul said. So I'm here to speak for the ones that are able to speak for themselves. That they unable to afford the water bill that's on the head that's going to be coming their way. And you got Lawrence in them. If they wanted the water, they could have built their own water plant. They don't have to get out water. They can cap it and go somewhere else. But yet it ain't about that. It's about that big filtration plant down there. You had our members of Local 2286, train this company that y'all voted to come in. And then was threatened. If they don't train these people, they will be cut loose or punished. But yet, once again, I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm just a voice. One voice. The public got to hear what I got to say. Because this is serious now. It's not just me. It's not just Mona. It's all of us. We all going to suffer, our kids going to suffer for the bad decisions that we made. And who's going to do our jobs after we pass on? Maybe Hamilton will just come and take over Trenton because they feel those that they can govern our water better than us. Because that's basically what they're doing. For 169 years, we control the water. And they feel though they just want to come in and have a say. That's all I want to have to say that. They want to take over. Otherwise, more like share, I think it is. But who cares? Paul don't know what he's talking about. He's just talking. But that's not fair. And I'm asking y'all once again that I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to challenge you. I have to. I have to challenge you, because for every person in the city of Trenton, I have to be a voice for them. I have to stand up for them, because maybe they don't have the money, and God blessed me with the money to help them. So I'm gonna help them, and I'm gonna do my best to help them, and Mona's gonna do their best to help them. You know, and y'all really, really gotta make better decisions on the workers. That's in the city of Trenton. Because we suffer down here. We're not eating down here. Think about us before y'all make such a quick decision on we're going to do this and we're going to do that. Because on October the 22nd, or it might be October the 29th, the bill go ahead in the Senate. Now, because if they don't see it on the docket that day, they can push it back through in a second. That's how fast it is. And believe me, I can smell the scope on this one. God bless you.
Paul Owen.
number one parking in Trenton. As I understand what was presented, the concern was visitors and state workers being able to have someone park. In a way, I didn't see anything about the residents of Trenton. Mr. Clayton did mention that the median income is like $35,000, and it is a tax on poor. And not only that, as being in a wheelchair since 2005, there is virtually no handicap parking that is not occupied by someone who is at work at a job. And as a result, I received a ticket for parking in front of where I was going to pawn shop at that time. And I was actually going down to Mill Hill, and Grace Little was there. And I, you know, had spoken to the mayor when he had his events that, you know, were in the park. And I attended most of them. And at each one, I asked him, where is the handicap parking supposed to be? And on that day, I just went down there. I went to the pawn shop earlier. And I went down there to tell him, to ask him again, where am I supposed to park? You know. And in that 10-minute span, my car was towed, ticketed and towed. And I spoke to him about it. Somebody came and told me that my car had been towed and it was supposed to be taken care of. But as a result, I worked for Mercer County Board of Social Services from 1975 to 1994. And, you know, I'm retired with a total disability, so I am disabled. And I can't understand why my car would be towed in a 10-minute span. And I ended up paying $723 to get my car back. Although I guess I contacted the wrong council member who has helped for that. And I called the mayor's office several times. And with that, I wanted to say, when you plan events in the city, you bring the city together, you know, and you leave out a large number of constituents, meaning elderly and disabled, at these events, if you see one or two people in a wheelchair or disabled, that's a lot. But you have all these senior buildings around here, so that's saying something. That's saying that they're not being served, they're either afraid, or they're not provided for. They're not provided for. And I'm just saying that it's absolutely shameful that there is no handicap parking. You know, I mean, there's got to be at least one other one other than myself. And that's all I wanted to say. If you bring the city together, you're trying to do things, let's do something for the people who live here. You know, if you're going to have concerts in the park before dark, because a lot of other people are afraid to go out at night. They're afraid to sit on their own porches at night. That's horrible. And something should be done about it. But it doesn't appear that anybody cares that they're not continuing. We don't care that people from the state get parked that day. You know, I gotta go to the pawn shop too, because I'm disabled. I gotta go to the pawn shop. So I gotta go down here, take my TV, and get $50, and get a $65 ticket, and then get my car towed to the tune of $723. That's not right. That's all right.
Thank you. Majesty Dubon.
Good evening. My name is Majesty Dubon. I'm going to file something to tell you about the New Jersey. Anybody here? Well, anybody in here above reproach. I'm not above reproach, nobody else is here above reproach. Is anybody in council above reproach? So, they call it doing the knowledge house. Doing the knowledge over here. The knowing principle knowledge. They know better. And it's listening to this issue. And it's the observing. And it's the respect. And out of all the things that took place in here, the only thing that settled was the council were at large. And the council were at large bigger. So it's a respect aspect for the people that's in here. Because, like y'all said about the venue street, if somebody was being disrupted, they probably didn't have a rule. Shell would be in trouble. Michelle's still here. See, it's rules and regulations that govern any house you go to. Why don't they apply to everybody except particular individuals in certain situations? I don't think that's cool. I'm offended. I seen a man get up right next to me and leave because he was offended too of the conduct. I think y'all want a people apology if you ask me. And I don't think there's nothing wrong with y'all being a man and a woman about it to do that because I don't think you deserve that. This is leadership. We can't get along. You think we're gonna get something done when we can't get along? Really? I mean, think about it. I mean, who am I? Guess what's my opinion? Right?
President Brock.
Sir. Could you go back?
Well, yes, sir.
Can you ask the floor?
Can I? It doesn't matter. If you could stay until a public comment or see a comment, I'd like to address your concern. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the council at this time? Seeing none, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Go to work, not because I want to make friends. I want friends, I get out of the door. I go to work to make money to pay my bills.
code on course. You try to better the next generation, and the President and the Council have the same opportunity to do that here. I'm confident from my own experience, if you sat down with your union leadership, say, listen here, here's a list of things we need to work on. Can we come together for some common ground here? It's not a matter of, you're going to say this, you're going to take that, if you want to get, you know, go scratch yourself and you know, get down the road. That's not what I'm describing, and I don't see that here. What I see is an opportunity to do things like water utilities, you know, I've seen a lot of communities where they gave up the private water to a public company, like the city birthday, where they gave it up to Middlesex Water now, manages it. There's a fee that comes with that. So maybe for them it's streamlining, it's more efficient, but you're still losing money from the city. You're losing city jobs for city employees. Yeah, Councilman Blakely made some very good points before when this gentleman to my right was talking about the leaders and how it's going to adversely affect the residents in different parts of the city. If you have to give up jobs because you're paying the people more than you outside the budget, I'm not saying that the law director is worth the money. I don't know if fella, maybe he is, I don't know. The bottom line is you have a, literally it's a budget. You got to find a way to work within it. So all I'm trying to encourage you is to do just that, is to get your union representation, your union leadership in to say, I can work towards a common goal. You talk about, Councilman Blakely talked about, if you give these people in the poorer section of town a ticket, they're going to lose their car, lose their job, they lose their ability to do these three things that we don't want to do for our families. If you start limiting jobs, it's not just the car they got to worry about, it's their houses, their ability to pay their taxes, to pay the salaries and benefits of everybody sitting here in front of us. The Aspen brothers and sisters, we in Lansing and Aspen, we consolidate New Jersey, we our communications great, our training is great, and our skills at being better people, better union workers has increased as well. We do vote. We make sure everyone's registered. We get out and vote. We support those people that are labor friendly. And we don't forget from November who's done things like costing people jobs with the municipalities or the governments that they work for. I just think it's again, as a parent who's had to look at part of the budget, but I'd like to, more expensive sneakers or a car that's not 21 years old. Yeah, I would. But I got to look at my budget. My budget dictates I can do this, I can do that. I can do 3 years and 2 years in college at the same time. Take some loans. Now, again, loans with bonds, same thing. You take college loans, it takes 20, 30 years to pay them off. These are the choices we make. But as a government, it's not literally your blood, your children. Paying these college loans for. This is the city. This is generations of people who take a lot of pride and say, I'm from Trenton, my parents are from Trenton, my grandparents are from Trenton. You know, you hear people talking, and other people at the different union meetings talk about, hey, this guy's all going to school, this one's aunt, and a grandfather, and they talk about schools that are no longer here because they're so old that they knock them down and things like that. There's a lot of people, like, when they see they're from Trenton, they wear a badge of honor, just crying because of the history. You know, he said, 169 years of work on this, someone said, I mean, for goodness sakes, that's almost a dynasty. There's a lot of things to be proud about in the city of New York. And it's just important communication with skirmishes between house members. I get it. I'm not naive to politics. I don't think any of my brothers and sisters are. But we need to be responsible to those people that are doing work for us and with us. We talk about, you know, making the city better. But even in order to make it better, one way is to make sure the people from the city properly compensated, treated fairly with respect. You know, it's my understanding that in Woodbridge Township, if you want to be an employee, you have to live in a township. I do. The house I live in now is next door to the house I grew up in. My grandfather had a house built in the early 30s before my father was born. My kids went to all the same schools I went to. These are some similar stories I hear from talking to some of my brothers and sisters. There's a lot of pride when people say they're from Trenton. It's almost a battle cry. I would hate to see that go by the wayside just for fiscal advantages. When companies that want to come in and privatize this, and we don't want city employees, we want to bring people from outside to come in to do the work. And then you're, so what do you really, when you do that, you're telling the people in the city, you're not good enough to do this work, or no, we don't want to do that. You know, I said it tonight for the first time, this fellow Wally, who's being called the works director. I heard the promoter from within, and I started many years ago from the ground level like I did. I think that's fantastic. I think that's a poster child or something you should come up to everybody's city. Here, we did right by you know, the hometown guy. He came in the front door at the basement level and worked his foot up, and there he is, he's the department head. That is tremendous. I will beat the drums and sing songs about that. This man right here is a success story in the city of Trenton. I'm lot more people that